It's really a pleasure to be here. So I was told this is a very informal group, so I'd be very happy to run this very informally. Please feel free to interrupt with clarification questions and short questions. If you have devastating objections, it'll be more fun if you keep them for the end, so at least I can get through a talk without having to grapple with those. So. Okay, I'm just going to talk through the handout, and if time allows, there should be some extras for the end. But we'll see where we get with time. So my topic today is the notion of consequence that is relevant for epistemic modal sentences. So sentences like 1 and 2 on your handout. Sarah might roll the die. If Sarah rolled the die, it came up even. I'm going to assume, for the purposes of this talk, that indicative conditionals, like chu, are some kind of epistemic modal sentence, and we can analyze them with tools from our toolkit for epistemic modality. And the claims that I'm going to be making, so I'm going to be talking specifically about consequence, although what I say will also have repercussions for things like the semantics of indicative conditionals, and in particular the probabilities attaching to indicative conditionals. So the claim that I'm going to make an empirical claim and a theoretical claim. The empirical claim is that we can observe a kind of split behavior with respect to the inference patterns of involving these sentences. These inference patterns appear valid by the light of all or nothing judgments, and invalid by the light of probabilistic judgments. This is a peculiar situation that I think applies specifically to the case of epistemic modality. And the way you're going to explain this is by suggesting two bridge principles between consequence and constraints on attitudes. So actually, there's a kind of epistemology component also to the talk, which goes to justify Stefan calling me an epistemologist. So, one bridge principle connects a broadly classical notion of consequence to constraints on probabilistic states, like credence. And a second bridge principle is going to connect another notion of consequence, one that is broadly dynamic, what is known in the literature as informational consequence, and I'm going to say what this is, to constraints on acceptance states, so states that are kind of all or nothing. And I'm going to say something about what I mean by acceptance. So a few options that this is supposed to have. On the one hand, hopefully we'll say something, I will add something informative to a debate on modus ponens that's been dragging on for a long time in philosophy. There's going to be an option also for what kind of contents we should ascribe to epistemic modal sentences. In particular, I think there's going to be support for a kind of non-propositionalist position about these sentences. And then there are going to be, if time allows, I'm going to talk about some spillovers about probabilities of conditionals. Okay. So I'm going to be talking about a set of inference patterns that involve epistemic modal sentences and epistemic conditionals. I'm going to use one running example, and the running example is going to be modus ponens, in part because it's a famous case in the literature, and so it's a good thing to talk about. So as a preliminary definition of modus ponens, I'm just going to assume that modus ponens is, you can identify what counts as a modus ponens in natural language just by replacing clauses in the schema that you have midway through page one. This will have to be qualified somehow once we give a semantics and a logical form, but for the moment, I assume that we're going to be able to recognize what counts as an instance of modus ponens just by plugging things in the schema, if phi psi and phi, hence psi. Okay, so let me start by asking you some intuitions about some sentences. Here's a context. It's very simple. Don't cheat, don't read ahead on the handout. So Sarah has tossed a fair six-sided die. and for convenience, name the die. Die. You have no information about the outcome of the coin toss. Now, consider sentence C towards the bottom of page 1 on your handout. If die did not land on 2 or 4, then it landed on 6. Here I put to you the question, what level of confidence do you assign to this sentence? Low, middling, or high? How many people say low? How many people say middling? How many people say high? By middling, do people mean 50-50? Or somewhat higher than zero, but... Okay. That's a telling face. Interesting. Okay. So repeat the exercise for P2, die landed even. This seems a pretty clear middling case. Okay. Repeat the exercise for P1. If die landed even, then if it didn't land on 2 or on 4, it landed on 6. This seems a pretty clear case of high. Okay. So I was a bit surprised by, even though the ratio of low to middling answer was still favorable to the low answer, I was a bit surprised that 4 or 5 people answer for the middling, because usually what you get is that people say that C should not have very high probability. Usually if you ask non-philosophers, that's the answer that you get. You get that at least C seems to be seems to have lower probability attaching to it than P2. I think if you ask people, they will tend to give you this kind of judgment. I'm gonna assume this kind of judgment for the purpose of this talk. I'm happy if people want to challenge that, so please let me know. So I'm gonna assume that the pattern of answer is low, middling, and high. So let me take a theoretical step. Let me say that when I asked you these judgments of confidence, what you gave me was at least a rough estimate of your credence in these sentences. And although I'm going to be talking about credences as having precise numerical values, I can easily kind of give up this and treat it as a fiction. What I need is that we can have degrees of belief and that we can distinguish between degrees of belief, and these degrees of belief can be more coarsely identified than probabilities are. Okay, so let me introduce at this point a probabilistic version of modus ponens, what I call neat probabilistic modus ponens. And this is a principle that says that if the probability of a conditional, if item psi is 1, then the probability of the antecedent has to be smaller or equal to the probability of the consequent. Now, this probabilistic version of modus ponens follows from basic facts about probability plus the principle of centering. This is the principle that, at least as I'm going to have it today, the principle that an indicative conditional, if item psi, entails the corresponding material conditional. Probabilistic modus ponens, P and P, is a special case of a more general principle. You only have to keep this in mind for 5 minutes, and then you can forget it. So the more general principle is going to be useful 5 minutes down the line, but in general I'm going to run with the simple principle because it's all that I need for the rest. Okay, so if the judgment that I'm assuming are correct, then we have a counterexample to probabilistic modus ponens, because we have that if even, then if not 2 or 4 and 6 is going to get probability 1, even is going to get a kind of middling probability, and if not 2 or 4 and 6 is going to get low probability. So there's an issue here, and presumably if you buy into these judgments, the thing to say is that, well, you have to, if you want to reject P and P, then you have to reject either centering or some features of our standard way of thinking about probability. Presumably, even though you might have worries about probabilism, presumably probabilism is not what is at stake here. So this is clearly a direct challenge to the centering principle, which is the principle that underlies modus ponens in conditional logic. Let me mention right away two resistance strategies. The first way in which you might worry about what I've told you is, well, first of all, you might worry, I've been assuming that the complex conditional, if even, then if not, 2 or 4, then 6, gets full probability. And you might have worries that anything about logical truths should get full probability, probability 1. So this is called the claim that only logical truths should get probability 1 is known as the regularity principle in the probability literature. It's actually kind of arguable that that claim should might count as a kind of logical truth in a broad sense, but bracket that, I could grant that P1 should get probability that a probability is very high, though not quite 1, and still rerun my argument with the generalized version of P&P that I've given you. So that principle does not require that a conditional has probability 1, but it requires basically all that you need to get a similar problem is that you have a drop in credence between P2 and C that is greater than the amount by which P1 falls short of probability 1, and you still get a problem. I'm mentioning this just to say that I don't think that the problem that I'm raising really relies on assuming that the major conditional gets probability 1. I think the argument can be run on kind of weaker premises. This said, I'm going to bracket this option, and for simplicity, I'm just going to assume that P1 is going to get probability 1 for the rest of the talk. A second worry you might have, which is a common worry that people have when they discuss modus ponens and similar principles, is going to involve a kind of equivocation. This is something that is often raised when people run sort of arguments that I would like to run. And the worry goes as follows. It's, look, you have a conditional, if not 2 or 4, then 6. If die didn't land 2 or 4, then landed on 6. That conditional is evaluated in different ways when it's on its own and when it is part of a complex conditional. In particular, it is evaluated with respect to a kind of different information state, a different body of information. And so, the argument that you've given doesn't have the right form to count as an instance of modus ponens or as an instance of the kind of argument that probabilistic modus ponens is supposed to apply to. And the reply here, and again, I'm basically taking a reply off the shelf from the literature, and the reply here is to distinguish two kinds of claims. The first claim is that really two different epistemic states are involved in the evaluation of this conditional. And the second claim is that there's some kind of context dependence that makes it the case that you use two different epistemic states. Or anyway, if it's not context dependent, something that doesn't have to do with the hardwired semantic features of conditionals. And what you need to make a real claim of equivocation is really the stronger claim that the reason why this conditional is evaluated in different ways doesn't really depend on conditional semantics, but rather on something else, maybe on context. And I think once you see this distinction, it's pretty clear that the equivocation response looks pretty weak. Because I'm happy to say that clearly there's a kind of shift in information that happens in the two conditionals. But it's also pretty clear that the shift of information is due to semantic features of the conditional and not to things like context dependence. For one thing, if you had genuine context dependence, you should be able to see at least two readings of at least one of the two conditionals, which you really don't. Right. You might still be worried about what we should count as genuine modus ponens and whether I am categorizing as modus ponens something that should not be categorized as modus ponens. This worry doesn't really matter for my purposes, because it doesn't really matter in the end what we stick our label modus ponens on. What matters to me is showing that there are some patterns of inference that display a certain kind of split behavior when you think of them with probabilities and when you think of them basically by accepting the premises. And this point is going to go through independently of what we in the end decide to call modus ponens or not. And in fact, you know, as I'm going to say shortly, this issue will apply to things that are also different from modus ponens or pseudo modus ponens. Okay. So one question you might have had is, am I not really just somehow rehearsing an argument that is well known in the literature? And that is McGee's argument for the invalidity of modus ponens. So McGee's argument is a bit different because it requires that you, it doesn't have a kind of middling, it doesn't use explicit talk of credences and uses premises that, at the very least, both receive very high credence. But it's easy to construct a kind of McGee-style version of my example. And here it is. Sarah tossed a die, a fair six-sided die. You caught a brief glimpse of the face that came up on top. You're very confident, but not quite certain, that it landed on Chu. In any case, you're very confident that you saw few dots on the face that came up. Now, in this case, it looks like we want to be quasi-certain of P1 and P2. So if die landed even, then if it didn't land on 2 or on 4, it landed on 6. This is pretty safe. Die landed even, you're very confident of that because you're very confident that it landed on 2. But you don't want to be very confident of C. I didn't land on 2 or 4, then he landed on 6. Now, the key difference between what McGee says in his paper on modus ponens and what I say, what I want to say here, is, well, the McGee wants to say the following. Sometimes the conclusion of an application of modus ponens is something we do not believe and should not believe, even though the premises or propositions we believe very properly. And this is a claim that I want to resist. So I want to deny that one may rationally accept the premises of modus ponens and reject the conclusion. Let me give an argument for this. So there's been a lot of literature, there have been a lot of attempts at resisting McGee's claim on modus ponens. One of them is put forward by Tony Gillis in a 2004 paper. And Gillis says that McGee's argument relies on a sort of equivocation. Basically says, look, the only reason why you're inclined to dismiss the conclusion is that you're kind of wishy-washy about the premises. But once we endorse, once you really commit to the premises, there's no way to resist the commitment to the conclusion. There's no space between that. And so Gillis, he kind of puts this forward as an argument, but it's really just a claim. But I think there's a way to test. There are many ways to test this claim. And here is one. This is here in building on a useful test that Peter Kletcher, a linguist Peter Kletcher, has devised for other purposes. And this is a test about patterns of agreement and disagreement in conversation. So suppose that you have a conversation between two people. And one says, if die landed even, then if it didn't land on 2 or on 4, it landed on 6. And die did indeed land even. And B replies, yes, that's right. Hence, if it didn't land on 2 or on 4, it landed on 6. This sounds a fine thing to say. This sounds the obvious way to continue the conversation. Contrast with, yes, that's right, but we still don't know whether if we didn't land on 2 or on 4, landed on 6. This is a strange way of continuing the conversation because it looks like B on the one hand wants to agree with what A has said, but on the other hand wants to hold back agreement. So I want to say, once you accept the premises of modus ponens, then you also are committed to the conclusion. This, at the same time, that this, while holding that, your credences in the premises and the conclusion of a modus ponens argument can be such that there can be a drop between premises and conclusion that amounts to failure of validity. This may seem a problematic conflict, but actually I want to say this is fine. This is what we should say about modus ponens and about a series of other patterns of inference. And what I'm going to do in the rest of the talk is show how we can actually hold these two claims together and how we can actually, I'm not really going to define a new semantics or define a new notion of consequence, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to link existing notions of consequence to principles about reasoning. Not exactly dynamic reasoning, but rather static constraints on mental states in a way that we can hold on to both claims. Before I do that, let me notice that what I've said is not just specific to modus ponens. There are going to be a whole other series of patterns of inference that display this kind of behavior. And here are three, and now I'm page 4 of your handout. What is called, what has become known as Lukashevich's principle. So that's the inference from not phi to not diamond phi. Not P to it's not possible that P. What I call antecedent introduction, this is simply from phi to if psi, then phi. And something that is well known in the conditionals literature, or to if. And this is the principle that allows you to infer from phi or psi to if not psi, then phi. I'm not going to rehearse empirical arguments for the claim that these also come out in the same way, but here is one thing to observe, that P2 and C actually, assuming a principle of just replacement of equivalent, already count as an instance of or to if, right? So the inference from even to if not 2 or 4 and 6 is basically an instance of or to if you assume that even is equivalent to 2 or 4 or 6. Okay, I'm going to actually discuss an example of Lukashevich's principle at the end of the talk. So I have not gotten any questions yet, and I'm not sure whether that is because everything is proceeding incredibly smoothly or people are saving all their objections to the end. So please let me pause and let me ask whether there are any questions so far. Yes, please.
Dumb question,
please.
The centering principle. That's supposed to work for. Okay. Here's a conditional that seems true. Mm-hmm. If you're 9 feet tall, you're greater than 7 feet tall. False. But if you're 9 feet tall, you're larger than the sun. Doesn't seem true. Another false. But if the English conditional goes from an if then to a truth functional conditional, you shouldn't have two cases that are FF, one of them true and one of them false. So I'm curious, I haven't gotten to the end of the paper, but I'm curious why I haven't read the Lewis recently. Why would someone believe that the English conditional obeys this centering principle.
So I thought the claims that you had were claims were intuitively the English conditional is false. Right.
Well, the first one is true. If you're over 9 feet tall.
Then you're right. Okay. Right. Sorry. But the second one. Yeah.
Subjunctive. They're indicative. You can do any subjunctive you like. You can put into it. I think a true indicative as well. So, at least that one is true. If you're 9 feet tall, you're more than 7 feet tall.
Yeah.
And then another. So that was true. False. Other falses are going to strike most readers as if you're 9 feet tall, then one is equal to zero.
Oh, I see. Yeah. So the claim is not that the indicative conditional in English should be analyzed as the material conditional, but rather that there is an entailment.
Okay.
Right.
Well, if it's an entailment, then you shouldn't. It's also if any English conditional entails the material conditional, then you shouldn't get these two cases. At least the material conditional.
Yes, but so you, so in the so but your second case was the case that was supposed to bring trouble.
That would strike people as false.
Right, but the notice that the corresponding material conditional would be true, right? Because it would be either you're not 9 feet tall or whatever. The moon is made of cheese or something. So it's not, while I agree that it's not, the conditional is false, that's not a counterexample to the entailment because it's not a case where you have a true conditional. And centrally, I mean, look, in the end, I think that at least on some relevant notion of consequence, centering does fail. So actually, I don't want to defend this too much, but I think it does require a bit of work, and I think on some other notion, you're actually gonna have centering. Yeah.
Let's ask, because for some reason it's not occurring to me. How is your argument not simply an argument against probabilistic Modus Ponens in a formal system?
Could you say more about what you mean in the formal system?
I mean in pure probability calculus, which would seem to, I certainly believe in the proof given, but the counterexample you're providing doesn't, I don't quite see where it takes advantage of natural language.
Why? Oh, good. So, well, I'm assuming that probabilities attach to natural language sentences, right, among other things. At least we can map natural language sentences to objects, such that probabilities attach to those objects. And I'm also assuming that when I ask you about a confidence judgment, then in a sentence, what you're giving me is a judgment of the probability that you assign to that sentence. So the connection to natural language is supposed to be, well, probabilities can attach, among other things, maybe indirectly, to natural language sentences. And moreover, when I ask you for judgments, what you report is, you know, your intuitions of a native speaker of natural language.
Must be phrasing my question poorly. I apologize.
No.
We'll have to come back.
But why don't we go back to it? Yeah. Why don't we come back to it at the end? Any more questions so far? Okay. Okay. So here's the suggestion, at least in outline. What I'm going to do is define two notions of consequence. The first is a kind of broadly classical notion of consequence, and is going to capture truth, a kind of set of proper points of evaluation. So it's not going to be the most general notion of classical consequence that you can get, but it's still pretty much a classical notion. The second notion belongs to a family of notions of consequence that are in a kind of so-called dynamic galaxy, even though actually this is the least dynamic of the dynamic notions. And what it does is it captures basically a notion of preservation of entailment at a body of information. So the idea is that if a body of information entails certain premises, then it's also going to entail the conclusion. Okay. And the idea is going to be that these two notions. So there's debate in the philosophy literature about. Well, a lot of times, it's not clear exactly what the debate is about, but a lot of times it seems that the debate is about which notion of consequence is the appropriate notion of consequence for capturing epistemic talk and conditional talk. There are people who have made the claim that, you know, one claim that you find in the literature is that we should switch to a dynamic notion of consequence, some kind of dynamic notion of consequence, because that's what really tracks the behavior of natural language. What I'm going to suggest is that these notions of consequence should really be understood in relation to attitudes and to constraints that we, to normative constraints that we have on attitudes, that hold on attitudes. And in particular, that these two notions of consequence impose constraints on different kinds of attitudes. So the bridge principles that I have, that I'm going to propose, are what you have towards the top of page 5 on your handout. These are both informal statements. I'm going to have a slightly more formal statement later on, but this is basically going to give you the juice of what I'm going to say. The first, and a classical consequence, the credence principle, says if psi is classically entailed by a set of premises, a rational subject's degree of disbelief in psi is at most as high as the sum of the degree of disbelief in the premises. And degree of disbelief is just a notion that I borrow from Adams, and the degree of disbelief in a sentence is just 1 minus your credence in the sentence. And the idea of what CCC says basically is just that your level of credence in a conclusion should be at least as high as your credence in the conjunction of the premises. So it's really the basic notion of probabilistic validity. And together with this, I'm going to suggest a notion of a principle that links informational consequence, which is the kind of dynamic notion of consequence I'm going to use, to a notion of acceptance. I'm going to say what acceptance is in a second, but let me say what the principle says. This says that if an argument is informationally valid, then a rational subject is going to either fail to accept one of the premises or is going to accept the conclusion. This is obviously very simple. And what I'm going to do is show, actually I'm going to sketch a model of attitudes without really stating it in full, but I'm going to gesture towards the way that the model works, that a model is going to vindicate together both principles. So once you see principles of this sort, you may think there's a choice, and you know, either there's a choice to make or we have to endorse some kind of substantial pluralism. But this is not going to be the position that I'm going to go for. I know that I'm at UConn, so you know, this is probably more fertile ground for pluralism than a lot of places. But nevertheless, what I think we should say here is not be pluralist, but just say that in a way we're capturing different features of the same underlying model. Okay. So let me say something about acceptance. This is a notion that is going to be familiar to philosophers and to linguists, not so much maybe to other people. This is a notion really that comes from Stolnacher. And acceptance is just basically a generalized notion of belief. Acceptance is kind of the broadest possible kind of doxastic mental state, is the broadest possible kind of taking a proposition as true for some purposes or others. So belief is a kind of acceptance, but supposing, assuming, imagining are all kinds of acceptances. Desiring is not a kind of acceptance. So it's just a notion of essentially taking a proposition as true, which you know, we can model as a proposition being true in a certain body of information, and that's all that I'm going to need. I'm also assuming that propositions are accepted in a kind of joint state in conversation, And so I'm going to assume that when something is asserted and it stays there unchallenged, then it is accepted in a conversational context. And this step is important because it allows me to use facts about what happens in conversation as evidence about acceptance in general. Okay, so this is the plan. Let me check. Okay. So what I'm going to do is, first of all, set up quickly kind of semantics for epistemic models, and then define consequence on top of that. The notion, the kind of semantics that I choose is a, for those in the know, is a kind of information state semantics. So that is a semantics that is going to evaluate sentences. Well, usually people evaluate sentences relative to worlds, at the very least. In addition, an information state semantics evaluates claims also relative to an information state. It's basically a twist on standard semantics for modality of the kind that your linguistic speaker for today is basically Kratzer has built starting from the 80s. So the important point is that interpretation is relativized to a world and an information state. The meaning of modals is what you have on your handout on page 5, under 4 and 5. Box phi is going to be true just in case all the worlds in the information state, in the relevant information state, are worlds where phi is true. And similarly, for diamond phi, just with existential quantification rather than universal quantification. So this is pretty standard semantics for modality, aside from the fact that you track the information state parameter separately away from the word parameter. Following again a long tradition, I treat indicative conditionals as a kind of covert modal statements that involve a kind of covert modality. And indicative conditionals, I'm assuming that they involve a kind of covert epistemic modality. And if clauses are going to have the job of restricting the domain of quantification of a modal, and in this case, they're going to restrict the relevant information state, and the way I define it, just because it's fashionable to do so nowadays, is by this operation of update that I symbolize with the plus. But it's just a pretty standard kind of semantics for modality. The reason why you track explicitly information states is just that it makes it easy to use them to define consequence. So it's actually very easy to switch between two different definitions of consequence if you have a semantics that is set up in this way. Okay, so let me get to my notions of consequence. So when you first learn to define logic, to define a notion of consequence on a semantics, that is kind of the Montague Kaplan tradition, the first notion that you encounter is truth at a point, which is what I call classical one, logical consequence. So this says that a set of premises, that psi follows from a set of premises phi 1 to phi n, just in case, for all points of evaluation, you know, if all the premises are true at all points of evaluation, then the conclusion is also true at all points of evaluation. I'm going to restrict this classical notion of consequence to proper points of evaluation. Which is going to give us the first notion of philosophical interest, and that is preservation of truth at a proper point. I'm going to say that a point is proper just in case. So remember, we have two parameters: a world and an information state. I'm going to say that a pair of a world and an information state is proper just in case the world belongs to the information state. So proper points are ones in which essentially, the W is a member of the I. Classical true logical consequence, which is what I'm going to focus on, is the notion that you get by operating this kind of restriction. And the suggestion is going to be the classical logical consequence captures something like reasoning from premises that reasoning for premises that are epistemically possible. Let me just say, reading this definition is possible that it's, well, anyway, you'll tell me if there is a mistake in the definitions. I find it very hard to read and talk. Now I'm wondering whether I wrote exactly what I wanted to write, and you'll tell me whether I made a mistake by writing up the handout. But it should be pretty clear what I have in mind. So let me switch to,
Just before you switch, could you maybe say a bit about why classical sub 1 is not of philosophical interest?
Yeah, so classical sub 1 is going to have all sorts of junk in it, right? So in particular, it's going to have points of evaluation where, say, you have the current epistemic state that that we have, but a world where, I don't know, Romney has won the election against Obama or something like that. And so what that's going to invalidate is, that's going to produce some kind of counterintuitive patterns, like it might be true that, so a sentence like Romney is president, but it must be that Romney is not president is going to be true at that point of evaluation. And the claim is that just doesn't track the way that we reason with these claims.
So the thought is going to be like there's no interesting or useful bridge principles that are going to connect to a classical one?
Yeah. So basically that's that invalidates the T axiom for epistemic modality, which is something that you want.
Can I also ask something about this? I mean, I was wondering about this too. I mean, this is what gives you centering, right? Basically, the W is a member of I. That's what gives you centering. The conditional entails the material conditional. And that's what you need it for, I believe. Or is that not right?
That's not going to be the case, because actually you can define informational consequence just by your further restriction of the epistemic states that you consider.
Well, so, but at least such just saying, sorry. So according to the definitions you've given so far, mm-hmm. centering is not entailed unless W is an I, I think, right? And be that as it may, I was actually wondering if that's the only reason why you have this properness, because I don't actually see another reason for having it, because. Saying that W is a member of I is basically saying that the relevant epistemic agent or informational mm-hmm. agent has no false beliefs. And I think our reasoning with modality and conditionals does not depend on whether our beliefs are false or not, should not actually play a role, because we don't even know if they are false.
Okay, so... let me disentangle two things. So, what I'm saying is that these points of evaluations are the ones that you as an agent regard as open epistemic possibilities. So, I'm treating epistemic possibilities as pairs of a world and an information state. So, I'm thinking that, you regard as an epistemic possibility, way that the world might be, and also what your epistemic state is about the world. So in order to admit an improper point as an epistemic possibility, we should admit that you can regard a world as the world you might be in, but at the same time, you might think that your epistemic state excludes that world. I'm not saying that that's... So it's still a substantial claim to say that those epistemic possibilities have this kind of restriction. I think it's different from what
okay,
you had
yeah,
in mind.
So, you know, so you're saying, I was thinking of looking from the outside at, mm-hmm. at the reason, but you're saying...
So
internal perspectives.
Yeah, so
okay.
The claim is that these are the possibilities, treating possibilities as a large kind of object.
Mm-hmm.
These are the possibilities that an agent that at least is builds in and that has is subject to certain constraints, rationality. These are the possibilities that an epistemic agent would regard as epistemic possibilities
okay.
for them.
That makes sense. Thanks.
You're welcome. Any more questions about this? Okay. So the next notion is the notion of informational consequence. So as I said, this belongs to a kind of general, broad dynamic family of notions. And the idea here is that consequence aims at capturing what follows from what is accepted in a given information state. So formally, I define acceptance as truth, acceptance in an information state as truth in all the words in the information state, in a pretty obvious way. And informational consequence is just defined as, psi informationally follows from phi 1 to phi n, just in case for all information states such that phi 1, phi n are all accepted at I, then psi is also accepted at I. Now, one thing that is not often remarked on, but if you think about it, it's pretty clearly true, you can define informational consequence from the second notion of classical consequence, and hence also from the first, by restricting the points of evaluation quantified over. So in a sense, in the same way in which we think of classical consequence, classical true consequence, as a special case of a general notion of truth at a point of evaluation, we can think also of informational consequence as a special case. And similarly, there's a line that I don't, I'm not necessarily going to push, but a line that you can see from here where you can think that really these notions of informational consequence really are focused on really, well, are really derivative from a basic notion of classical consequence, which is really what undergirds the whole apparatus. This is, I'm not really interested in pushing this line here. There's definitely going to be some resistance from some quarters that really like dynamic consequence in this kind of claim, but I'm not going to push on it. Okay. So, let me just state a definition of modus ponens. It's just what we had before, but assuming the kind of logical form that I use for conditionals, one thing to notice is that given that I assume that conditionals in natural language come with a necessity model, actually this is for the board, it's going to be useful because I didn't put it on the handout. So the way in which you'll be able to observe modus ponens in natural language is going to be most often in this form. Let me also say one more thing. What's up? Please.
Is that my eyes or is that impossible to see?
First
is phi, yeah, sorry. This is phi. And this is phi. Why don't we make it A and C? So. So Let me add one twist to the semantics for those of you who are in the know. I've just given a universal semantics for conditionals. We could essentially switch over that semantics to one that builds something extra, namely builds borderings in, and builds also a so-called centering semantic condition in, that basically says that if the actual world is in your set, then the one closest world is going to be the actual world. And that's not going to change the results. And in a way, what this shows is that what is called the semantic condition that goes under the name of centering and the axiomatic principle actually come apart once you are in a semantics of this sort. So basically, once you are in a semantics that uses restrictors and information states. But anyway, this is just for those of you who are familiar with this kind of maneuvers, just to flag. This is, I'm going with a simple semantics, but complicating the semantics slightly is not going to change things. So it is a fact, and I'm not really going to rehearse the proofs here, but it is a fact, it's well established that given the kind of semantics that I've given, modus ponens and all the other patterns of inference that I've mentioned are going to fail on a classical notion of consequence, are going to be valid on an informational notion of consequence. For a, I'm going to very briefly sketch a countermodel for the die case. And the countermodel is one in which you have six worlds. And your word of evaluation is W2. And in this model, the two premises are going to come out true. I mean, the first conditional comes out true everywhere. The claim that dial ended even comes out true because you're in a world where dial ends true. But the second conditional is not going to come out. Is not going to come out true. And I'm not going to go through the proof in detail, but of course, I'm very happy to go back to it if people are interested. Okay, so how am I doing time-wise? Sorry, is there a clock in the room?
No.
So I swear I'm not checking my email, I'm just looking at the time. Okay. So, okay, so bridge principles stated in full form of glory. I'm actually not going to read them, but basically they really say the same things that I mentioned informally before. The first one says that if an argument is classically valid, in the sense that I defined, then the credence function of a rational subject is going to be such that the drop that you observe between premises of conclusion, basically there's no drop between the conjunction of the premises and the conclusion. The second principle, ICA, is going to say that if an argument is informationally valid, then the information state of a rational subject is such that either all the premises are not accepted, either not all of the premises are accepted, or the conclusion is accepted. Both of these are synchronic constraints on rationality. And I'm going to leave it open. It's an interesting question whether one can come up with similar bridge principles that concern dynamic constraints on rationality. There are more dynamic notions of consequence than informational consequence in the literature, and it is an interesting question. Fabrizio Cariani has posed it to me, and I don't know the answer, and it's an interesting thing to think about, whether some of these can be mapped in a kind of productive way to dynamic constraints on reasoning. Okay, so the next part of the talk is the one where I don't exactly describe a full model of full model of attitudes that vindicates both principles, because that would actually be pretty gruesome and pretty boring. But I can just tell you how you build this kind of model. And it's actually pretty simple. It's just a standard probabilistic model. Only your basic objects in the algebra are not worlds or whatever states you usually have, but are just pairs of worlds and information states. You assume a probability distribution that works in the usual way. And then you add some extra constraints just to capture the way in which epistemic modal reasoning works. So one of these ways is just a propriety constraint, so the one that Stefan was kind of questioning me about. So you just assume that a rational subject will only assign positive credence to proper world information state pairs. And in addition, well, the only controversial constraint is that, this is relatively controversial, but in a way you need them for the proofs. You assume that epistemic possibility requires positive credence. There are a few things to say about this. It might be that this is not strictly necessary, that there is another model out there, but this is the way that I set things up. In a way, what I'm interested in is not exactly giving the most realistic model possible for epistemic model language, but just to give a possibility proof. There is a way in which we can build a model that represents both credences and acceptances, and that validates both bridge principles. One feature of the model, unsurprisingly, is that credence one and acceptance are going to be equivalent. This is fine for me, because what I want to say is that once your credence in the premises of a modus ponens shoots up to one, then you should also have credence one in the conclusion of a modus ponens, and similarly for all the other relevant inference patterns. So rather than telling you more about formal, about exactly how the model works, what I want to convey is why we have this peculiar behavior, because I think it's, once you see the basic point, it is pretty intuitive. To see this, I ask you to focus on sentences 10a and b towards the bottom of page 8 on your handout. It is raining, and it might be raining. And to consider how you evaluate these claims in the kind of semantics that I've sketched. So a claim like 10a, it is raining, is evaluated at every, once you have, suppose you have an epistemic state that consists of three worlds. A claim like it is raining is evaluated pointwise at each world in the information state. So what matters is what goes on at each individual world. And so if you have three pairs, then you know you're gonna look at the world component of the pair. Conversely, for a claim like 10b, it might be raining. To assess whether this is true or false, what you do is you look at the epistemic state as a whole, and you check whether in the whole epistemic state there is a world where it's raining. If there is a world where it's raining, then the claim is true, and otherwise it's going to be false. Now, once you throw probabilities in, this is going to make model sentences like 10b peculiarly insensitive to differences in the probabilities of individual worlds. So consider, go now to page 9 of your handout. Those are two very different ways in which you could apportion probabilities to the worlds, the same worlds in an information state. And suppose that, say, W1 and W2 are rain worlds, and W3 is not a rain world. So this movement of probabilities across different worlds in an information state is obviously going to make a difference to the probability that you assign to it's raining or it's not raining. But as long as you have one rain world with some probability, the probability that you assign to it might be rain is going to be the same, right? Maybe you want to be resistant to the idea that this place should get probability 1, but the idea is that there's going to be a certain level of insensitivity. As long as there's an open option, there's an open possibility that it's raining, whether the possibility gets high or low probability, it might be raining, gets high credence. As soon as credence is moved completely away from rain worlds, you have a sharp drop from, well, the model, the toy model that I have, from 1 to 0. But in any case, from something that is very high to something that is very low. This kind of behavior, this kind of extreme insensitivity to small adjustments with sharp drops is what is acclaimed, what is at the origin of this kind of split behavior of certain patterns of inference and epistemic sentences. And just to give you a last illustration of the phenomenon, here's another principle that I mentioned early on, Lukasiewicz's principle. This is the inference from not phi to not diamond phi. So, for example, from it's not raining to it's not the case that it might be raining. You might assign 11a, it's not raining, very high probability. But 11b is not something that you're going to accept. You're not going to have, you're going to have basically zero or very low probability, as long as you think that there's a possibility that it is raining, right? So you might have very, very high credence that it's not raining. But as long as it's not certain, you're just going to give zero or quasi-zero to, it's not the case that it might be raining. Because sure, it might still be the case that it's raining. As soon as your credence goes up to one and it's not raining, then you flip. And you're going to assign very high, near 1 or 1 credence to it's not the case that it might be raining. Okay. I have some further tricks up my sleeve, but since there are only 25 minutes left, let me close now and let me see if there are questions. Thank you.